Deliberate practice is the incorporation of structured activities designed to improve performance. And that sounds rather intuitive, but it's really that repetitive practice with observation and feedback from a coach that makes practice deliberate. Deliberate practice is a more powerful predictor of accomplishment than is experience or aptitude. Thus, innate talent is not as important as hours of deliberate practice. And I think that's great news for those of us who may not feel innately talented. Anders Ericsson has shown us that master musicians and athletes need up to 10,000 hours of deliberate practice in order to develop their expertise. And it's crucial to understand that it's the quality of the practice that's as important as the quantity. In medicine, the use of deliberate practice has been associated with better performance and lower complication rates in both clinical skills as well as procedural skills. So for example, studies have shown that for central venous catheter insertion and for advanced cardiac life support, that the success rates are higher and the complication rates are lower when deliberate practice is used. It's important to know, though, that deliberate practice isn't universal among medical students or trainees, and so we encourage the development of these skills early on in your training. Deliberate practice requires several elements. First and foremost, you need motivation and concentration. Then you need a set of clear objectives on what is to be accomplished, followed by focused repetitive practice and measurement of your performance with feedback from a coach. In the end, deliberate practice requires significant effort. In Lead.Serve.Inspire, we use direct observation of students by the faculty to ensure you're meeting your core educational objectives in professionalism, patient care, and communication. We believe that through the use of direct observation and the use of deliberate practice, that is the best way for us to help you develop your expertise. Our faculty will observe you in simulated environments, both in our clinical skills center as well as in the classroom. More importantly, faculty will observe you interacting with real patients in various clinical environments. We ask faculty to document these observations of you so that you have written feedback on the strengths of your performance as well as areas needing growth. We also ask faculty to determine whether they trust you to perform a skill without direct supervision. Early on in skill development, it's common to receive a not yet on this entrustment item. This is your signal that more practice is needed. As you learn the skills of patient care and communication, use the course objectives to guide what you should be learning, making sure you understand the why of it. So why am I asking this patient a particular history question? Or why do I examine the heart this way? That will help you be more focused in your practice. Once you've done it, ask for feedback. Feedback is hard to ask for, but it's such a crucial step in this process. And then go back and do it again and again and again. Each time, maintain your level of focus as you continue to practice. If you're deliberate in your practice, for any skill, you move from novice to advanced beginner to competent, proficient, and finally to expert diagnostician and clinician. But don't think the learning stops there. Even faculty and experts continue to practice and get additional coaching.